Congress shall not pass a law abridging religion, speech, press, peaceable assembly, and petition.
We need dissent in this country. We need for there to be groups that feel the freedom to criticize the government, to speak out.
I'd like to feel we're going to win our battle in Congress to get Congress to pass a law to turn the FBI into what it should be, a Federal Bureau of Criminal Investigation, which is what we want and need.
Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. The First Amendment to the Constitution of the United States. These 45 words are the cornerstone of American democracy. But to make these words a reality, each generation had to struggle against those who would abridge these precious freedoms. What you are about to see is the story of how close we can come to losing our First Amendment rights, and how one particular organization, NCARL, the National Committee Against Repressive Legislation, has fought to keep these liberties alive. Our right as Americans to dissent, to disagree with policies of our government, to speak freely, to be heard, is at the core of what democracy is all about. But since Watergate, what has emerged through congressional investigation, citizen lawsuits, and inside leaks to the press is that for decades, the FBI has been secretly working to suppress those voices that its director, J. Edgar Hoover, and others have wanted to silence.
Most of us would think that some left political party would be the primary target. One of the largest FBI files is the Quakers, the American Friends Service Committee. It's an enormous file.
And among Frank Wilkinson, Executive Director Emeritus of NCARL, has worked for civil rights and civil liberties for much of his life. Since discovering that he and others in the organization had been a target of FBI disruption and spying, Frank and NCARL sued the FBI in 1981. Eventually forcing the FBI to cease their unwarranted surveillance. The story which emerged during the suit of the FBI's attempt to destroy the civil liberties work of NCARL is a chilling reminder of how far some governmental agencies will go in preventing citizens from exercising their rights of free speech and freedom to dissent.
The significance of the 1980 NCARL lawsuit against the FBI is that it brought to light a tale of FBI misconduct that is so vivid and so troubling that it should serve as a warning to all of us about the dangers of excessive governmental power.
Look at this. That is 4,000 pages of FBI documentation on me. The total is 132,000. 31 times higher than this is what was involved. Somebody said something about our balancing the budget. Let me tell you that the attorneys at Loeb & Loeb, who handled this case as an ACLU volunteer counsel, estimate that the FBI spent $17 million in following me over a 40-year period from 1942 to 1982. $17 million.
Why did the FBI spend these millions of tax dollars investigating the activities of one organization and its director? Were they tracking down a dangerous criminal? Protecting our national security? What led Frank Wilkinson to become one of the FBI's 10 most wanted political activists? There is little in Frank's early background to suggest he would have been of any interest to the FBI at all.
My family were all Republicans. It was a very beautiful family, very religious family. They gave me a sense of a social gospel, which can be very unique, I think, in the Methodist denomination. I had a real sense of social responsibility. What I had not been given was any reality of the real world. I was brought up in Beverly Hills and then UCLA, and I really didn't know too much about the real world.
After graduation from college at UCLA, Frank spent a year traveling throughout Europe, Africa, and the Mideast. The abject poverty he saw in the Holy Land disillusioned Frank and shook the very foundations of his religious beliefs. When he returned to the States, instead of entering the Methodist ministry as previously planned, Frank was drawn to the social activism of the Archdiocesan Director of Charities, Monsignor Thomas O'Dwyer.
And he and others, with a new committee he had formed, showed me that the housing problems I saw in Bethlehem were true in Los Angeles. I was absolutely shocked when I was taken 8 miles from my lovely home in Beverly Hills to the ghetto in the barrio of Watts, and I couldn't believe it, that we had these problems here.
Frank threw himself into the work of bringing quality, low-cost housing to people who now lived in slums. He and Monsignor O'Dwyer led the fight for integrated public housing in Watts. They protested that the new housing projects were planned to be racially segregated and pressured the housing authority to fully integrate the new communities. After finally winning this battle, Frank was asked to join the Los Angeles City Housing Authority.
And so from a picket line, you might say, in front, I'm taken inside to become the manager of the first integrated housing project in the Watts area in 1942. That is the month that the FBI labeled me as a national security risk and proceeded to follow me for the next 38 years of my life. And we have this unbelievable file record. There's not one record in these 132,000 pages that shows any inference that I committed any illegal act or criminal violation, not one. It all has to do with my work, first, for integration, and secondly, that I began working to abolish the Un-American Activities Committee.
The growing menace of communism arouses the House of Representatives Un-American Activities Committee. Among the well-informed witnesses testifying is J. Edgar Hoover, head of the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Mr. Hoover speaks with authority on the subject.
Communists have been, still are, and always will be a menace to freedom, to democratic ideals, to the worship of God, and to America's way of life.
As part of the Cold War, thousands of U.S. citizens were called before the House Un-American Activities Committee, or HUAC, and questioned about their political beliefs. Some cooperated with the committee, naming names of those they thought might be left-wing or communist.
One chap I'm thinking of currently is Mr. Howard Da Silva. Always seems to have something to say at the wrong time.
Others, including the Hollywood 10, refused to cooperate with the committee, standing on their First Amendment right to freedom of belief, while still others invoked their Fifth Amendment protection against self-incrimination. These unfriendly witnesses were blacklisted. Jobs and careers were lost. Lives ruined. In addition, those who invoked the First Amendment were cited for contempt of Congress and sent to jail. Frank Wilkinson was one of these. Knowing he faced a possible prison sentence, he offered himself as a test case for civil liberties, refusing to answer the committee's questions. Frank was immediately fired from his job, and after losing a 5-4 Supreme Court decision, he and his co-defendant, civil rights activist Carl Braden, were sent to federal prison for 1 year.
My wife, Jean, and I had 3 children. They were then, I think, 12, 14, and 16. We didn't know till the last minute we would have any income at all to support ourselves on, because nothing had been arranged. Jean herself had been blacklisted out of her job as a social studies teacher the same time that I was blacklisted out of my work in housing. By hindsight, I think that going to prison was the most important decision I ever made in my life. It was an act of civil disobedience. There were many people who opposed it. You'll go to jail, as though that were something essentially wrong. But to me, it was a matter of registering my intense anger at that committee for the violations it was making of the First Amendment.
Frank emerged from prison more dedicated than ever to the defense of the Bill of Rights. He had worked with others to form the National Committee to Abolish HUAC, and now he spoke throughout the country about HUAC's threats to our civil liberties. Unknown at the time, the FBI and HUAC had worked closely together for many years, and now the FBI began a campaign designed to silence the National Committee's opposition to HUAC. As later revealed through government documents, the FBI sent hecklers to meetings, mailed out anonymous smear tactic letters, harassed financial supporters, and actively worked behind the scenes to have public meetings canceled. But despite these efforts, the movement to abolish HUAC grew. After the successful abolition of HUAC in 1975, the National Committee changed its name to the National Committee Against Repressive Legislation. NCARL continued to pressure Congress to enact legislation protecting our First Amendment rights. They worked to expose such FBI programs as COINTELPRO, or Counterintelligence Program, which sought to suppress protest during the tumultuous 1960s. Under COINTELPRO, the FBI disrupted the activities of those involved in student rights, civil rights, and groups opposed to the war in Vietnam. The FBI was linked to the assassination of Black Panther Party leaders, and the FBI used blackmail and taped phone conversations in an attempt to prevent Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. from receiving the Nobel Peace Prize. COINTELPRO was officially closed down in 1971, but similar programs, not authorized by Congress, but enacted under presidential executive order, continue to this day.
Under Reagan's new guidelines, beginning in 1983, they started an investigation of the people who are opposing the administration policies in Central America. Not spy upon them, I mean disrupt what they're trying to do. Place agent provocateurs within these organizations. The only reason we even found out about it is that the lead informer for the FBI, man hired to do it in Dallas, Texas, had been told to go out, and he was told to investigate a group called CISPAS, Committee in Solidarity with the People of El Salvador. And this FBI agent, his name is Frank Borelli, came back to the FBI and said, you know, these are just good people. Sister so-and-so is the Catholic nun in Dallas, is the president. They're not doing anything illegal. And the FBI handler said, you go back and you'll find where they're keeping the guns. And he said, he'd go back and look for guns. He came back and said, not only are there no guns there, but he said, this is ridiculous. Put me on something else. And he said to them this. He said, look, last night at the meeting, you know, he's there as an undercover FBI agent sitting in a peace meeting. He said, look, last night at the end of these meetings, I always help pick up the chairs. That's my cover, you know, help. You know, people think I'm very generous. I helped fold up the chairs after a meeting. And when I was through, Sister so-and-so, whatever her name is, walked up to me, and she took my hands and said, thank you, brother. And she put her cheek next to mine. Thank you, brother. The FBI informant at that point said, that is it. We will get you an apartment. You get that sister to your apartment, and you seduce her. Then you'll find out where they're keeping the guns. And this FBI informant is bad a character as he was, that was too much for him.
Shortly after this incident, Frank Varelli's cover was blown and he quit the FBI. After a dispute over pay, he went to the Dallas Morning News with this entire story. infiltration of the peace movement is but one of many recent FBI investigations aimed at silencing the voices of social change and free thought in this country. Anti-nuclear, women's rights, and environmental groups have been targeted as well. Today, NCARL is fighting harder than ever to stop these infringements on our liberties. A small core of committed staff and volunteers across the country are working to educate the public. And NCARL has become a very active presence in Washington, D.C., where it lobbies Congress to preserve our First Amendment freedoms.
First of all, NCARL has developed a petition addressed to the members of Congress asking that a bill be passed that would control and set guidelines for the investigative activities of the FBI, and that in particular would ensure that those investigative activities do not impinge upon areas of constitutionally protected free speech and association.
As a direct result of the NCARL petition, H.R. 50, a bill aimed at stopping FBI political surveillance and redressing executive abuses of power, has been introduced to Congress by Representatives Don Edwards and John Conyers. NCARL is also active in the struggle to limit CIA covert action around the globe. And in addition, NCARL's Richard Criley, longtime director of the Chicago office, who now serves on the National Coordinating Committee, has written a book entitled The FBI Versus the First Amendment, published by the First Amendment Foundation and based on the NCARL lawsuit. This book chronicles the history of unconstitutional FBI activity.
The newest target to come to light is the librarians of this country. The FBI actually has a program called the Library Awareness Program. The FBI argues that if they know what books people are reading, they will be able to determine a profile that helps them to determine whether or not you are prone toward terrorism.
Now, what assistance did the FBI want from librarians? They wanted us to monitor the reading habits of funny-looking foreigners, and then to report back to the FBI what these funny-looking people were reading.
This is not the McCarthy years. This is 1990, and today, 1991, as we go right up to our Bill of Rights celebration. The FBI is doing that in America today.
Sometimes I am hard-pressed to understand the motivation of a federal agency that will devote the hard-earned tax dollars of its citizens to such essentially unproductive activity. It is fundamentally, in my mind, a lack of trust in the citizenry, because the whole foundation of the First Amendment is the belief that the public is in a position to evaluate, make judgments about all the information that comes to them from whatever political sources, so that the response to what the FBI perceives as dangerous speech should be more speech, not suppression.
I think it's the time for us to look closely at every part of American government. And wherever we find an agency of the government, whether it be the FBI or the local police force, violating basic parts of that Bill of Rights, is to act and act effectively to put an end to it. Congress shall not pass a law, that's what it says, abridging religion, speech, press, peaceable assembly and petition. That is the cornerstone of building a better world. Without that, we can never make progress. With that, we can go forward and make all the basic fundamental changes that our country and the world cries out for.
This land is yours.